How are y'all doing these days?
Doing good.
Good. Brett, good to see you. It's been a long time. I know, Brett. Good to see you, man.
I saw your name up there. I was like, oh, Matt's going to talk about fish and wood. This will be good. No one knows more.
Yeah. Well, you did a lot of this stuff in the Arkansas, too, so this will be fun.
Yeah. We're still doing it. Wherever we can.
Yeah.
All right. Well, let's get started here. We're probably going to have people roll in like we normally do, but it'll be recorded. So if they miss the beginning of it, they'll be able to find out what Matt was talking about earlier and stuff. Matt's been a close friend to folks at River Shared for years. I think, I don't know, probably since about 2008, he's been kind of connected to a lot of the stuff on the ideas of maybe sharing information and doing a river share type group. So with that, we really appreciate everything you do, Matt. Matt's a research, aquatic research scientist at Colorado Parks and Wildlife. You've been around river restoration work, I'm guessing now for what, 15 plus years, is that correct?
About 15 years, as long as I've known you, Dave.
That's right. So. All right, well, I'm going to let you know. I'm going to turn my stuff on mute here quick.
Okay, excellent. Well, hey, thanks everybody for getting up early in the morning, and hope you got your coffee enough to kind of, because we're gonna go through some information. I've got a lot to share, but I want to make sure that you guys have time at the end to answer any questions. So I'm going to get going. The main part of my talk or title is response of trout populations and pool depths to large wood in streams. And specifically, we were using towwood. So I'm going to get into that. If you don't know what towwood is, I'll give you some explanation later through the talk. When we're doing these evaluations of restoration projects with fisheries, we use two real primary study designs. One is an extensive post-treatment type of study design, which basically means we are looking at over a very short time frame, maybe 1 to 3 years of data collection, using a lot of sites, so extensive number of sites, and trying to look at control and reference sites in addition to treated sites, and a lot of, again, sampling a large number of locations. The other method we use primarily is a BACI study design, which is a before after control impact. I'm not going to get into a lot of that with this study, but this was an example of an extensive post-treatment. So where I'm going to be talking about, if you're familiar with Colorado, we're working right smack in the middle of the state in a place called South Park. We have four big parks in Colorado, but this one is located near a little town called Hartzell, which is way up at around 9,000 feet in the high country of Colorado in a giant park up there. So like a lot of places out here in the West, we have a legacy of human impacts and things that we're still trying to recover from in terms of trying to benefit both native fish populations and sport fish. Some of those impacts have been from gold mining. You can see an example of that with that gold dredge on the upper left corner. We had a lot of overgrazing done over many years from sheep and cattle. We had cattle drives with cattle as far away as Texas. Folks would drive herds from Texas all the way out west here up into South Park and then back again at the end of the fall. And then we also had, of course, a lot of agricultural conversion of riparian areas into hay meadows, which in order to maximize hay production, you've got to get rid of willows. Willows are in the way. So you want to maximize surface acres. So you've got to somehow get rid of the plants that aren't part of your operation for hay. So there's a lot of legacy of impacts in this area. As a result, though, we have about 58 miles of leased fishing access in South Park. That's a lot of room for people to go out and fish. But this is kind of what you'd see in a lot of places. If you go up to South Park, this is kind of representative of a lot of the habitat you'd find. Not a lot of willows, very over wide channel. And you'll a lot of times see, you could be fishing on a section of stream like this and have bison or cattle not too far away from you. There's open access for all, a lot of grazing. So not a lot of riparian fencing. So when we did an assessment, we went through and looked at what are the limiting factors to our fish populations, mainly our sport fish, rainbow and brown trout fisheries. We identified overwinter habitat and lack of deep pools for adult fish holding is one of the primary limiting factors. And it's not uncommon. If you've been around and done any work out here in the West, you'll see that this is a common issue out here, the lack of deep pool habitat in our rivers. So what we wanted to do is we wanted to say, okay, well, what can we do about this? Can we do some experiments with different restoration or enhancement treatments to see if we can try to fix that problem by developing deeper pools? So what we did is we used one of our state wildlife areas, that SWA stands for State Wildlife Area. It was called Badger Basin on the Middle Fork of the South Platte River. We had a mile and a half of stream that we thought we would try experimenting with different approaches to try to develop deeper pools and overcome some of these limiting factors for trout. So what we did is we used three different treatments primarily. I'm going to run through what those look like. Oh, sorry. Let me first explain. We use towwood treated pools as well as non-wood. So we locations where we didn't put any wood in the channel. But first of all, what is towwood? I'm not going to go because I think most of you have familiarity with this treatment type. Towwood is simply the use of large wood limbs, primarily woody material, installed at the toe of the outside bend of a bank, primarily like on lateral scour bends, used to stabilize that toe. And then what we would do is we would replace topsoil and transport sod mats and live willow transplants, willow clumps, or other woody vegetation, including plantings, direct plantings in the bank on the outside bend that we hope over time would establish a living stream bank that would, as the wood decomposes and rots over time, the living stream bank would take over the functions of stabilizing the outside bend. So that's my description of what towwood is. You might have a little different description, but that's in general the way we use towwood out here. Here's an example of the three different types of pools that we were interested in evaluating. So we did use construction techniques with heavy equipment to create these pools. We use excavators to excavate these non-wood pools. So here's an example of a guy working on excavating this pool with his excavator. And we size the dimension of the pools based on a reference reach from upstream to get our lengths and max depths in the right kind of ballpark. And then that's essentially the gist of what we did, shape the point bar, and did not add any wood intentionally into this pool. Now, in contrast, the second type treatment we evaluated was called a haphazard towwood treatment. Many of you probably done this kind of work where you are using root wads with attached stems, maybe 15 to 20 foot long stems, and we're weaving them into the stems are being woven into the bank to create a layer of that underlayment material that stabilizes the toe. Then, so here's an example of kind of a construction sequence showing how it's done. Here's a location where we had a blown out bank. We wanted to stabilize this location and try to establish willows at this location. So what we did is, starting off, we used the large wood, the trees with attached root wads. We're weaving them into the bank. In this case, we had inmates in a heavy construction program that were helping us. And they're the excavators placing the wood. Our inmates are helping arrange the logs. And we have about three layers stacked of these logs that you can't see under the water surface. But once those have been arranged and we use the boulders as ballast to hold things in place with the water there, because wood's buoyant, and then we place the brush material, topsoil, and then transplanted sod and planted willows in the bed. That's kind of what it looks like afterwards. So that's an example of what we call haphazard tow-wood treatment. And then the third one was what we classified as an undercut tow-wood treatment. Now, the goal of this treatment for tow-wood is let's maximize or enhance the function of the tow-wood as an undercut bank. So we arrange those root wads with stems, same as prior example, but they're all more or less oriented perpendicular to the bank lines, and they're cantilevered or more or less suspended over a footer log. So here's an example. I'll show you kind of, this will make more sense going through the pictures. Here's an example of a very overwide channel on an outside bend. The thawweg is actually running more likely, when we actually did the survey, about a third of the way from the inside of the bend. So the thawweg's way out, way off of where it should be. We excavated that outside bend, placed our logs in and arranged them in an undercut fashion. Here you can really see better what I'm talking about with those logs being suspended over the footer logs or the root wads ends. You can see that. And then we place our brush material on top of those logs and then topsoil and then transplant sod mat on top for the finished product. So why is this all important? Well, when we did our evaluation of costs, we live now, as you know, more than ever, we're all conscious of the fact that we have limited resources and these projects, you know, depending on the cost, how much money we have, we could do 2 miles instead of a mile of treated stream. It's, you know, you're limited in what you can do. So we wanted to see what is the relative effectiveness of these different treatments, given there's different costs involved. So in our case, and you may have different numbers, but in our case, by the way, this project was done, it was completed 2011. It was initiated in 2007 and it went all the way through 2011. However, so we use non-wood as a base cost. So this is our non-wood treated pool. Haphazard was 1.6 times more expensive when we installed the wood in a haphazard sense, that tow wood. And then the undercut cost was 2.6 times more expensive than base. So as you know, that all translates into higher construction costs and how, you know, how much, how far you can go with that dollar down the river. So after we'd finished the project, this is a 1.5 mile reach. What we did is we classified all of the pools that we had treated as either undercut, haphazard, or non-wood pools. We eliminated any pools that were not lateral scour pools because we had a few pools where we installed tow wood that were like confluence pools or other types of, you know, like tributary junction type locations. We didn't use those in the study. We wanted to be consistent and only look at lateral scour pools. The next thing we did in 2019, so this is now about 8 years post-construction, we randomly selected from our population of classified pools, and we had a sample size of 3 treated pools per treatment. So 3 undercut, 3 haphazard, 3 non-wood that we identified that we were going to use then incorporate into our study for looking at pools, pool depths, and fish populations. And then in 2021, 2 years later, so this is now 10 years post-construction, we repeated this study again using the same exact sites that we did in 2019 with the following 2 changes. We increased the sample size from 3 to 4, which you can see from here. So now we have 4 treatment treated pools per treatment type. And then we also included a control location, a control reach upstream that was about 2 miles upstream of our project reach. That's in blue on this map. And then we had about 12 miles upstream, a reference site, the Tomahawk State Wildlife Area, designated as that red square. So that's just showing you, this is the Middle Fork of the South Platte, and it's flowing from left to right. It's just giving you an idea spatially of where our control and reference sites are located. By the way, the control was representative of the impaired site what our project looked like, project reach prior to construction. So here's a few pictures just to give you an idea. This is our reference site showing kind of a representative condition. Notice we have lots of willows. We have presence of large wood in the channel, as well as more trees that could eventually fall into the river, conifers. This is a picture looking at the reference reach where we actually selected our actual pools for sampling. And then this shows our control sites. On the right is a photo showing a picture of the control, the condition of the control reach. You can notice that, and then on the left, that's a photo from our project reach from 2007 before construction was initiated. Notice we have similar issues with the bank's instability, accelerated bank erosion, fine sediments, overgrazing. So we had active grazing going on in both locations, and really a lack of overall of woody species like willows. So, and if you don't believe that that's kind of similar enough from the photos, we actually collected residual pool depth data from both our control site as well as the before the project site before we actually did construction. And those error bars are 95% confidence intervals. They both had roughly a similar residual pool depths, somewhere around 1.5 to 1.75 foot deep. And then here are where our control sites were located, looking at an aerial view. So what were we actually sampling? So what we were interested in sampling, we didn't just look at the pool. We looked at the run pool glide complex. So this was done because this was our logistically the best way for us to close off these locations so fish couldn't escape when we were using our multi-pass depletion methods for estimating population size. So we installed block nets up and downstream, both at the run location and the glide location downstream. So that's our sampling unit. Here's what it looked like when we were doing our sampling. We have an electrofishing raft with five trodes out there. Again, we use multi-pass depletion. So that way that works is we started at the downstream block net. We shocked all the way upstream to the upstream block net, turned around, went back down to where we started at the lower end of the block net there, the low block net. And that was considered one pass. And then we'd repeat that 2 to 3 times. And if we had what we do then is we could use the difference in fish, the depletion from one pass to the next would help us with generating a population estimate that we would then use to calculate the abundance of fish as well as the biomass or pounds of fish per area. So every fish that was caught was identified and weighed and measured and then returned to the river. So once we collected our fish information and then we'd also collected information, physical habitat information based on our residual pool depths and other factors that we measured in the field. We wanted to see what factors were most influential in controlling residual pool depth, the depth factor. We remember I told you our limiting factors analysis for fisheries said that deep pools were what we considered limiting to our salmonid populations, the trout. So what's residual pool depth? Most of you know, but just in case you need a refresher, residual pool depth is simply if you were to turn off flow in a river, which, you know, we can't just do that, although in Colorado, some rivers we can, but if we shut off flow in rivers in a river and all the water flowed out of the back of the pool and you had a static pool and you took the maximum depth, recorded it, that would be residual pool depth. The way we collect that in a flowing river in the field is you simply would find the maximum depth of the pool from water surface in a pool, and then you would find the deepest point at the riffle tail crest downstream, and you just do the subtraction of those two, the difference in those two depths, that would give you residual pool depth. Okay, so in results here, which factors, I'm going to get into results, which factors are most effective at maintaining the deepest pools? So we looked at wood presence, which is whether or not pool had wood that was at least 10 centimeters in diameter and at least a meter in length and covered at least 10% of the outside bend. Those were our criteria for calling a pool classifying as having wood present. We also looked at pool types. So pool types were the categories, like I mentioned, undercut treated, undercut tow wood, haphazard tow wood, non-wood pools, control pools, or reference pools. The radius of curvature, we expected pools with a tighter radius of curvature or a smaller radius of curvature based on the physics of centrifugal forces around the bend to have deeper pools. And then pool length, we thought if a pool was longer, it was more prone to having a lower sediment transport capability and possibly filling in. And then upstream riffle length, we thought a longer riffle upstream of a pool might have more momentum, more energy flowing into the pool to help maintain a deeper pool. So what those were the different factors we looked at when we ran multi-model inference and AIC or Akiaki's information criteria was used to help us rank which factors were most influential and explain the variability in the data. We found that wood presence was the best predictor. And so here's our model results with residual pool depths from wood from pools that had wood. Those were the undercut and haphazard tow wood treated compared to the control reference and non-wood pools that were lumped into the non-wood category. Those are 95% confidence intervals, those error bars. And we had a difference of about 1.5 feet of residual pool depth for wood treated versus non-wood treated pools. So if the goal is to try to establish deeper pools for overwinter and adult fish habitat, the towwood treated pools won hands down. Now we were interested in, okay, now that we've looked at what treatment types were most effective at maintaining deep pools, how about in influencing abundance and biomass of trout, in particular browns and rainbows? Those are what we managed for, rainbow trout and brown trout up in South Park. So again, we were interested in looking at what geomorphic factors might explain variability in brown trout abundance. That's the number of brown trout per 100 foot of pool length. We standardized all sites by 100 foot of pool by pool length. What we found looking at year. So we had two different years that we sampled for fish populations, 2019, 2021. And both those years had slightly different flows, like stream flows and patterns. So we thought we better include year to account for possible variability in flow conditions. Wood presence, pool type, residual pool depth, the length of the pool, and then upstream riffle length. The reason we thought upstream riffle length would be important to look at because we figured if you have a longer riffle feeding into a pool upstream, that's where all your aquatic macroinvertebrates or fish food is found. So if you had a longer riffle, you might have more surface area and therefore more aquatic macroinvertebrates or bugs, food for the fish that would drift into the pool downstream. So that's why we included that in the model. It turns out that pool type was the most important factor in explaining variability in brown trout abundance. So these are our results showing the numbers up above the bars are the order of magnitude increase in that particular treatment type compared to the yellow bar, the non-wood pools. So some interesting things, you see that the reference condition sites had the highest abundance of brown trout, which is what you might expect, about 6 times higher than non-wood treated pools. And then the towwood treated pools, the green bars were somewhere around 2.5 times higher than non-wood treated pools for brown trout abundance. What was interesting though, is notice the control pool it had higher abundance than the non-wood treated pool, which was very strange because our control, as you remember, was representative or indicative of the non-wood pool prior to doing any work. And what the thing that we concluded after looking at the results here is that possibly our excavation of the non-wood treated pools, we may have collapsed the outside bank, which had some undercut habitat just from the sod that was growing there. We may have actually collapsed and unintentionally lost some undercut habitat that still existed in our control site, but we actually damaged. Remember, non-wood pools actually were deeper, had deeper residual pool depths than control pools. We think that might be a function of the lack, the impact we had to undercut banks, but we're going to look into that. Which factors were most effective at explaining the variability in brown trout biomass? So that's the pounds of brown trout per 100 foot of pool. So slightly different metric than population abundance. We're getting more at, well, what are the size of those individual fish? So looking at those variables, we found that residual pool depth was the best explanatory factor for this. So this is brown trout biomass on the y-axis, residual pool depth on the x-axis. The blue dots are wood-treated pools, yellow dots are non-wood, and the green is a mixture of both. And what you can see is that for residual pool depths 3 feet and greater, we see a marked increase in brown trout abundance, or biomass, excuse me, or pounds per 100 foot of pool. And a nice relationship there with increasing residual pool depth leading to more higher brown trout biomass. Now we're looking at what factors would influence quality brown trout. That's brown trout that are 14 inches long and greater, their abundance. So what we found for that one, again, residual pool depth was the winner. So one point I want to make with this is notice that the line there, the dotted line, crosses about at 1.2 residual pool depth, about 1.2 feet. This could indicate something helpful, and somewhere maybe, and then you've got that yellow dot just upstream of it on the that intersects the x-axis there. At residual pool depths 1.5 feet and lower, we actually might have some idea that those are better place, like the type of depth we'd want for juvenile rearing to protect our young of year fish that are growing up, those trout, and avoid predation from bigger piscivorous predatory brown trout. If we can create conditions that are 1.5 feet or lower, those might be really ideal for avoiding some of those hungry large brown trout that would chow down on those little fish. How about which factors were most effective in explaining variability in memorable trout abundance? That's fish that are 20 inches or greater. So here we have results from 2019. Our first year, we had one fish that we captured at all sites that was 20 inches or larger. In 2021, we had 15 fish that we sampled that were 20 inches or larger. And of the 15, all were in towhead pools, none in reference sites, and only one other fish was in a control pool that was over 20 inches in length. All right, what factors are most effective at explaining variability in rainbow trout biomass, the pounds of rainbow trout per 100 foot of pool? We found that wood presence, so our towhead treated pools compared to all other treatment types were better or held the most highest biomass of rainbows, with 8 times higher biomass found in the wood treated pools than the non-wood treated. And then total fish abundance, that's species including long-nosed dace, long-nosed sucker, white sucker, northern pike, and rainbow trout, brown trout, and cutbows. Wood presence was our winner for explaining the total population, the highest number of total fish. That was in wood-treated pools compared to non-wood. It was 1.5 times more fish. From a carrying capacity standpoint, you see there's more fish then in wood-treated than non-wood-treated pools for all species. And then for all total fish biomass, that's the total amount pounds of fish per 100 foot of pool for all species, residual pool depth was our best predictor. With, again, the blue dots representing those towhead treated pools. And notice that kind of interesting line at 3 feet, residual pool depths of 3 feet and greater, were able to maintain those depths with wood treated pools. And those had the highest total fish biomass. And then I just have a second to run through a few of these before and after photos showing the differences in riparian response, before and after treatment. I just love these. You can see the shading characteristics those willows are providing over the pools. And notice the difference in the substrate, how much coarser we are now that vegetation's growing in and encroaching on the channel. That's better bug habitat, better food sources for those fish located in the pools downstream. And obviously the overhead cover from large wood suspended over the channel and willow providing shade and stabilizing banks. So in summary, large wood treated lateral scour pools maintained and created the deepest pool conditions. That's toe wood treated pools. And then wood presence was associated with increased abundance and biomass for rainbow trout and total fish. And wood is good for increasing brown trout population metrics, regardless of the construction type. So bottom line is, from what we've seen, there's no difference between haphazard and undercut toe wood treatment. The undercut method was a lot more expensive for us to work on and install, but apparently just placing large wood, whichever fashion you feel is most cost effective, is the bottom line. You can get away with cheaper construction methods. Lots of people to thank on this. Dave Beidelsbach, Dave Rosgen, Rod Van Velsen, my mentors, as well as Tyler Swar, our fish biologist I work with, Bill Rivley, our property tech, lots of great people. And this is what it's all about. Is we like to connect people with nature at parks and wildlife with fish and the fishing experience. And this is kind of the fruits of what we like to see. So that's it, Dave. If there's any questions, I can take those if we have time.
Yeah, we can have maybe 5 minutes for questions if people have questions. I have a question if nobody else has any, but go ahead and ask your questions if anybody has some. I can ask Matt whenever.
Yeah, I've got a question. I'm wondering if you thought that the kind of the arrangement of your pools had any effect on their overall performance. So it looked like when you showed the schematic of the river, all of your undercut pools came before your haphazard and then your non-wood in terms of the direction of flow. Do you think that affected anything?
Yeah, I mean, ideally, my study design, I would have liked to have a little more spatial overlap between, those different pool types. Our last year of sampling in 2021, I don't know if you noticed in my study design schematic, but we had some non-wood pools that were located within or downstream of our haphazard pools and vice versa. So we got some better kind of spatial separation between them. But yeah, our undercut treated pools were all kind of clumped together just based on the nature of when they were constructed at the furthest upstream extent. It might have something to do with that. And the way around it, I think, is our plan is to replicate this study at the Dream Stream, which is right here. You can see this photo. This is the South Platte downstream. We did another 2 miles with over a mile of toe wood that we installed. We plan to basically do the same type study that I just showed using that study design down here, and hopefully we'll have better spatial mixing. But what was interesting, however, was we did not see a significant year effect. If you recall, in all of my models, I included year for 2 different years. And for what, even though we had different flow conditions, year wasn't significant. Didn't seem to rise to the top of our model, you know, in terms of factors explaining our model results. So that was interesting, not seeing interannual year effect. But yeah, that's kind of the plan. Let's replicate the study at another spot. And then we'll get more weight of evidence to see how well this toe wood works around different places.
Thank you.
I have time for one more question. If nobody else has one, I have one more question, but I'd like somebody else to ask if they have one.
Hey, Matt, this is Brett. Good. Probably kind of a bonehead question from a fisheries perspective, but so when y'all have the nets at either end of the sampling reach, and then
yes,
when you count the fish, you just put it on the other side of the net, and does that impact what goes into the next reach? Like, how do you keep the samples kind of
separated?
Yeah, separated.
So yeah, that's a great question, Brett. And let me make sure I understand. You're asking how we would keep those different passes separate, I think, right? Or the sample for each pass, sample of fish?
Yeah, because I'm like, I guess you just have to, once you count a fish, you put it on the other side of the net, right? And then does it go into the next reach?
Gotcha. You know? Okay, I understand. Yeah, and I apologize. I didn't get into a lot of detail given the time we had. But the way that worked is we would, what we had was when we do the fish sampling, we'll set up, imagine like a laundry basket almost, where we put all the fish from one pass. So we'll start down at the lower block net. We shock upstream. We sample all the way, walking upstream to the top block net, come back downstream. And when we hit where we started, that's one pass. And all the fish that we capture go into these floating containers, like a net that contains all the fish from that pass. Then those fish are dumped into like a pen. And there's a pen that's set up with rebar, and it looks like a giant laundry basket. So you place that into the bin, and then we get going on a second pass. So then we start all over again. And then all the fish from that station are captured, processed. When we're done processing, we release them back into the site where we captured them. And then we move on to the next pool. So there's a chance that whatever the time is between when we sample one pool to the next pool, fish could move. But we work from downstream to upstream. And in general, when a fish is stressed, we tend to see them going downstream instead of moving further upstream. So contamination from one site to the next, I think, is minimal, just based on the fact that after we process those fish, they're pretty kind of knocked out, a little tired. They more or less either stay right where we, you know, where we release them in that same pool where we captured them, or they tend to kind of drift a little bit further downstream into sites that we haven't sampled or won't be sampling, because we're moving in general from downstream to upstream. Does that make any sense?
Absolutely. That clarifies it. So yeah, it makes a lot of sense.
Cool.
Matt, do you have time after the inspirational talk to take additional questions, or are you?
I do. I can stick around. You betcha.
Okay, good. Then so let's leave the additional questions for after the inspirational talk so we can get people on their way and not take too long today.
Sounds good. I'll stop sharing.
Yeah, we really appreciate your willingness to share today. We're really kind of excited about what you're finding is related to these projects, and excited that you continue on. The next section of our talk, if anybody's leaving, we appreciate you to be on today, but the next section of our talk will be on kind of inspiration of vocation. And this is kind of related to how we've been talking about an MMA series, or a mission, ministry, and adventure series. So with that, today we're going to talk to James Vitrano with Rochester University. And he's going to talk a little bit about kind of what vocation means and how they use that to help inspire kids at the university, and then just other ideas of life. So James and I had met on the Clinton River a couple of years ago. The river kind of brought us together, and we've had an opportunity to work on some projects. And it's amazing how we're giving gifts of relationships and experiences. And we don't always know what they're going to turn into, but usually through trying to walk in obedience and faithfulness, they become a lot bigger than what we expected. With that, James, thanks for joining us today.
Thank you, David. Happy to be here.
All right, James. So, I think we've talked on this series before that sometimes people would grow up and say, hey, if I really want to do something big, I want to be in a mission. If I don't want to go and have risks, then maybe I'll minister to others. And then if I don't really want to even minister to others, and that's kind of risky, well, then maybe I can just kind of show up and give to other people without having to worry about that, and just kind of show up show up here and there. And it's this kind of hierarchy of what mission, sorry about that. It's this hierarchy of kind of the difference between mission, ministry, and adventure. And I want to talk to you today about kind of what it means to train people and help show them what vocation could look like, opposed to saying, hey, you have to be in the missions or you have to be in ministry. So how does Rochester University
try to lead people towards vocation in training?
Sure. Sure. Well, thank you for that question. And we really have a focus on, and we try and define the term of vocation early for our students. So their freshman year, when they come in, we have a class that they have to take both their freshman year and sophomore year. Rochester University is rooted in a Church of Christ tradition, but we're a really open Christian campus to all denominations and non-people of faith, and really try and help students, when we talk about vocation, have them understand that it's a full life experience, and that God does not have a pre-plan for you specifically to be a thing. And we don't go out and try and find our thing, or, you know, ramble looking for the one fit of our purpose, but rather those gifts have been granted in you, and God has a purpose granted in you from the beginning. And so vocation is a term we use very intentionally to be full life. So your vocation, and God has a plan for all vocations. So if we talk to our accounting students, they can have an adventure in accounting, if we're going to go with your MMA thought, because God believes in a world that is structured and that is understandable. And accountants work very hard to make sure that the things that they do each day make the world more transparent, more honest, and more structured, so that we can step closer to God's plan for the world, which is all of us living in peace together. And so regardless of what profession they choose, we don't think profession and vocation are tied. Regardless of the profession, subcategory of vocation, and they can serve in God's world in a very meaningful way. And then we talk about vocation in your family life, vocation in your friend life, vocation in your faith life, and making sure that you keep balance there. So that was a...
Can anybody else hear James still?
No.
Oh, okay. Well, that's kind of a bummer, isn't it? All right, well, we'll continue on, and hopefully James can get back onto here. One of the questions that I was going to ask James, and if he comes back on, we'll ask him. You know, the Japanese culture and philosophy talks about something different between vocation, profession, mission, and passion. And a lot of times in a Western culture, in a Christian-based culture, we lose kind of difference between kind of mission, vocation, profession. And a lot of times we don't really know what the difference is. And I think we can borrow from some other cultures to kind of look at how other people have looked at vocation, mission, and profession, as well as passion, opposed to saying, okay, well, a lot of times we use the words interchangeably. Oh, my profession is my vocation. This concept talks about this Venn diagram where, you know, it's the idea of what you're good at, what you love, what the world needs from you, and what somebody will pay you to do. And this idea of how we deal with vocation is, you know, gonna be with us every day of our life. So here comes James. He should be able to come back. When we have a vocation, I think sometimes we try to separate it from the things that we love, from the things that we're good at, just because we can get paid for it. And we also kind of sometimes separate it from the things that are needed. And we say, well, it's just a job, you know, type of thing, opposed to saying, okay, well, it could be something more than that. So James, are you back? Let's see. I think James is trying to come in. We'll hopefully find him if he comes back in. I think the, I was going to ask James about kind of his thought. Historically, Western culture and the Christian church has viewed vocation a lot differently than we currently do. So James, are you there now?
Yeah, I'm on my cell. We just lost Wi-Fi in Rochester, Michigan. So, or something went down. I apologize for that.
That's okay. Well, we moved on to, since you weren't on there, I was going to ask some questions that I had anyways. But, you know, I think in kind of the Christian cultures, recent cultures, a Protestant denomination and a Catholic denomination sometimes has a difference in how they have a vocation. You know, Protestant, it's almost like a mission and profession and vocation are completely separate, opposed to saying there can be an interaction between them. Whereas a Catholic tradition has had a lot more people in the past, even coming from St. Francis of De Sales, that was before, you know, the Protestant Reformation, that talks about kind of vocations as being something that has that God can use in our lives and has special need to accomplish. So what is your thought on kind of how you get people reprogrammed, or how do you lead kids that come from so many different backgrounds on even the purpose of vocation, or even using the word vocation?
Sure. Thank you for that. I mean, I say this tongue in cheek. Luckily, a lot of our students don't understand the history of their own faith. So sometimes we get this blank slate as they come, and we welcome that. We also welcome students that are you know, steeped in their Church of Christ or Protestant views or Catholic views. But from day one, and I think, I don't know when I cut out, we start with their freshman year. They've got a seminar on what vocation is, and it's this whole life that is part of your vocation, that it's in you. And we are just helping to try and find your gifts that God's placed in you to help the world become more known as a place that is envisioned with the glory of God in mind. So really, from as we get them as freshmen, that vocation word, I think we have the bigger conflict, not so much in religious vocation, which often was used historically, but rather vo-tech, or something that is technical in nature. I think the high schools often use the term, not in a way that is consistent with how we think of a Christian vocation, which is having, you know, the impact on your family, friends, faith life, and your job as part of a vocation, all in which God granted you these gifts to be part of our community.
Yeah. Yeah, I think you're right with that. I mean, growing up, the idea of vocation in high school is always a lot different than if you go on a professional mm-hmm. way. And you don't really know why growing up, but it's always like, oh, okay, well, they're going to vocational school opposed to, oh, they're going for a professional degree, you know.
Right, and that narrowing of vocation is a problem from our perspective that we want to bust out. So whether you're narrowing it in a religious view or narrowing it in a technical sense or technical skill sense, we work hard that freshman year. And by the time they're seniors, I think actually by the time they're sophomores, they really start to understand how we're using the term.
So James, you know, I'm using this reference from this Japanese concept that I can't even pronounce. I think it's Ikigigo or whatever, but essentially it does this separation of having, you know, four aspects of life that come together, and that there's kind of this middle area that kind of combines your vocation, mission, profession, and passion. And it's not biblical based, but it's not against the Bible either. So when I looked at it, it's like, that's kind of a neat concept. And in a lot of ways, when we think about vocation and profession, we don't have a lot of things that say this is exactly what vocation means, but there's a lot of reference on how we can do a vocation in the Bible. So mm-hmm. how do you, are there key areas or places that you point students to when thinking about vocation from a biblical standpoint or from writings of inspiration that are kind of things that the students can latch on to and say, oh yeah, this really means something to me?
Yeah, I think you know, there's a number of texts we use. One is, it's a text, Living Lives That Matter. And I think it was assembled and edited by Cunningham. That takes a lot of biblical texts and brings them together. And what we're striving for is the Japanese intertwined circles is a really good way to think about that, that you have displayed here. But the Bible and certainly Jesus' mission was never focused on one thing. It was never, you know, it was work where we had to, you know, the profession we were in is where we had to find the meaning and the impact. It was the personal relationships. It was the relationships with our community, faith or not faith-based communities. It was a bunch of intertwined circles that probably are more infinite than four. And in the middle of that is your gifts. And I tend to stay away from the word gifts as the students progress in their knowledge. And it's just what you have inside of you that from the beginning, though God may not have the end plan for you specifically on a path, he does have this root in you that you can use to impact the world in each way that you live it. And certainly vocation and job don't tie in the Bible much at all. It is much clearer that it was a path to walk, not a preordained thing that you must do in order to get to the next level, as for centuries we may have thought.
Yeah, I think that's kind of true, though, with a lot of kind of these concepts that we spend a lot of time on in a Christian faith and just in personal walks. We think of things of, oh, well, what's my mission? You know, and that's kind of the same thing. It's not right. Overly biblical to think about a mission. It's more of a subtitle to the Bible than it is biblical teaching. So
yeah, and I would term the whole thing's a mission. Like we've just like we've narrowed vocation in some aspects to lose meaning, we narrow mission in to lose meaning. Our life here is the mission, in at least as we would describe it here. The other text that if people are really interested in, and I've got it, I'm leaning back a little bit, Hearing Vocation Differently, again, edited by Cunningham. That one is really powerful to me. If folks want to, for their own lives, read something that'll make you think about how you can.
Uh-oh, I think we've lost him again.
Right. In some cases, many steps deeper.
Yeah, your connection is still a little rough for us, James. We just lost you a little bit. But that was probably the most important thing you said the entire time and we lost it, huh?
You did. just get hearing Vocation Differently, edited by Cunningham. That's the one I want to leave for folks.
Good. All right. Well, you know, we hope to be... have some future involvement with Rochester University through RiverShared. As you know, we're excited about kind of how we can create vocational training that's centered around rivers and restoration and use you guys as a partner in that. So how do you guys look at creating a new vocational training, or how would you be like, hey, we're going to allow somebody to come and learn about this, or we're going to allow somebody to do this sport, or how exactly does Rochester University look at, hey, let's do something new?
Sure. I mean, one thing that's a little unique to us, a lot of universities have a build your own degree component. We actually have an IDS component that we allow students to build different majors and blend majors. But interestingly for us, we do house it in our biblical studies department. And so, you know, you don't have to be a ministry major, but if you want to combine biology and nonprofit management, you're going to do that out of that department. And then they will work with our department as the nonprofit management department to blend it together. So we're really open to students finding their own path. We're a small school. We don't have a ton of majors compared to some of our state school peers, But we really want to understand the students in that freshman year. And if they have a passion, we're going to find a really cool blended degree. Even our School of Business, we've got multiple pathways for students that are interested in a bio track or a nonprofit track or something else that we could blend for them.
So I'm going to take some passions that I have, and we had a young intern working for us that we had sent up there to visit with you. But his interest was in fisheries, biology, and outdoor sports and recreation. And we were saying, okay, well, we have this idea of a fly fishing golf course and stuff. So how would Rochester University allow somebody to kind of make a degree that's kind of very unique and then still give it value, opposed to being like, hey, look, I got a degree in underwater basket weaving?
Sure. For that specific, I would love to see them, you know, you certainly need the bio parts. So whether it was a major or part of a combined major, they need our environmental science degree. So we would kind of start as that base. But what I would love to blend for that student is either our sport management degree, which we have a really good program. And in fact, we offer one of our two masters is in sport management. So if I could have that student, I'd blend them a 5-year, get them an undergrad in bio and a master's in sport management. And that sport management degree, they really start to learn how to bring people together for things of enjoyment and probably help understand the finances and not only the importance of sustainability on a bio side, but that sport management degree in our business school will help them understand the sustainability on the money side. If they didn't want to be here 5 years and just 4, we would blend a major minor between bio and sport management here. So that's how I would help that student. And I'd be excited for that.
And then, so I'm going to speak for my friend Matt, just because he doesn't mind if I speak for him. But let's say Matt, he has an advanced degree, but he wants to go back for an advanced degree where it couples ideas of, let's say he likes fisheries and recreational sports and ministry. So how do you look at advanced degrees after there's already been an undergraduate degree that are kind of complicated? Do you have a mechanism for that?
Yeah, you hit on a couple. We don't have a ton of advanced degrees offered at RU. We do have a ministry advanced degree, and we do have a sport management degree as a master's. Both are cohort degrees with about 12 students. And both are well observed by our PhD's master's degree faculty. And they would blend their interests within the context. So they'd have to make a choice, ministry or sport management in this case, but they would blend that interest within the assignments, within the ability to pick research opportunities, within the ability to even pick the texts that they use within the context of the degrees. And whether it's Rochester University as a small Christian school or another small liberal arts school, we have a lot of disadvantages to the big state schools, but one of the huge advantages is 12-person cohorts, even at the undergraduate level, where we absolutely engage with our students on a daily basis. You know, if a student's missing my class, I'm texting them. And some students don't like that, and others, they're here for that. But I think anyone that's interested in blending something unique, look at your small liberal arts school. And because we've got the Christian piece, I think we've got that one extra piece that if you want that to be part of your experience.
Good. Do we have any questions for James before we kind of bring this to an end? So James, one of our big passions in River Shared is get people in wonderment and awe of nature. We think that kind of when you're in wonderment and awe of nature, it kind of connects you to the artwork and you can see the painter through it. You may not always understand it, but at least see it. And so how is it that you try to work in wonderment and awe of different teaching things into the sharing of a vocation with kids? So like in other aspects of training, how do you place wonderment and all? That's something that I've lost in some of my college classes where, you know, you get through it and you just don't really care what's going on.
Right.
So how do you, kids excited?
You know, I do a lot of experiential learning, and I think a lot of our faculty do a lot of experiential learning. And for me, it's the nonprofit majors that I have. So if I'm teaching a class right now with 16 weeks, five of those 16 weeks, we aren't on campus. We're at a nonprofit site. Two of the other ones, we're serving at a nonprofit. And they may not be nature oriented, and that is a great way to have awe and wonder. But when you're helping people within the context of a church or with the context of a food pantry, you can't help but be engaged. The spirit is there and won't let you fall asleep in the fifth row of my lecture. And so then we bring it back to class, and they're way more engaged at class after the class because they felt something. And I think today's students are paying a lot of money for not us to sit there and speak stuff that they can Google, but rather getting them out into these places is important. I know our Christian ministry majors do the same. Our mass communications degree, I know, goes out and works at the same nonprofits I do, but from a, how do they get their message out? And our bio folks really like to use their Western trips, their trips out West in the summer to do similar things. And now we've got a great river restoration that I know a couple of them are actually using in their classes.
That's great. Hey, I'm gonna do a quick prayer with you, and then we'll, if you can stay on for questions, and then we just appreciate everybody that was willing to be on today. So
thank you.
Dear God, we're so thankful for the relationships that you've given us, the opportunities to connect people. Just help us to be amazed by what you allow us to be a part of. Help us to be able to have a desire to want to share with others. We know that there's a world out there that's hurting, a world that's broken. We know that we're broken and hurting at times, but help us to be an example of hope in this life as we have people follow us. Help us to point them towards you in our actions, and when needed, we use words. We're amazed by you, and help us to live in ever more amazement. Amen.
Amen. Thank you.
All right. Thanks a lot, James. So thanks a lot, everybody. Have a great week this week. And James and Matt will stay on the line until nobody else does.
Thanks so much, guys. Have a great week.
Hey, you too, Vera. Thanks a lot, man. Hey, James, do you guys do cross country?
We do. We got an awesome cross country team.
Well, we got an awesome cross country guy, don't we, Matt?
We do. It's funny. I've got a senior in high school right now, and we're going through, James, that very thing of like, you know, for him, like, how do we help direct this guy? Yeah. Like, where should he go? And there's so much available out there. And as you know, it's like, I don't even know where to start with, like, other than obviously I appreciated the prayer, Dave, the aspects of prayer. That's a huge part of this whole thing. Like, Lord, if you don't help us with this, I don't know what we're going to do. So, but it's a super big challenge. Like, and this idea of vocation and, you know, taking their interests, and how do we, you've got all these interests, but how does that go into like something you can get paid to do? And I mean, there's just so many complicated aspects of as a father trying to direct my son here as a senior, you know, next steps.
Yeah, Matt, I can empathize entirely with you, because I can tell you all the great things about Rochester University or Michigan State, where I got my degree from, and you know, but I actually just went through what you went through. I've got a freshman in college this year, and it is just amazing. It's almost paralyzing, the choices and the weight that we put on this decision. And I was as guilty as anyone of, you know, not making it better for my daughter in terms of the weight of the decision. You know, it's really important to pick the right school. Is it a Christian school? Is it large? Is it small? Do they have many degree options? And honestly, having gone through the first, this thing, it doesn't matter as much as I think it did. It matters who she was, what we prepped her to be. And was a first school or second school, watching her grow in the dorm with her friends and now probably changing major. None of it was as important as the 17 years we spent together, walking together as a family. So the only thing I can share is it's not, you know, enjoy it more than stress on it, because
yeah,
God's got a plan there, you know, and hey, we love cross country. We love indoor track. We've got some folks at nationals right now this week. And
wow.
So it's you can't go wrong, I don't think. It's not as, it's important, but the process is more important than the choice, I think.
Yes, that's really good advice. I appreciate that. Is it too late to apply to your school?
Oh, no, it's not. You mean for the fall?
Yeah.
Yeah, no, it's not too late at all. For most schools, they'll even regardless, they'll take them right up to the end. They have these deadlines and these dates. But a lot of schools are interested in interesting students. So if there's a match there between the two schools, whether it's us or someone else, and it's June or July, often you can still have that conversation. There are dates there, but what I found is a lot of schools are still interested in conversations. And Matt, I'd love to talk with you or your son more, or have somebody here talk with them. And even just generally, they're just some really cool people to talk to, because our recruiters are young and not salesy. So even just having a conversation of, okay, we're thinking of big state school, and they'll tell you, you know, the good. They got a ton more options for majors. We've got chapel twice a week. It's almost, it just comes down to that matrix in your mind of which is the thing we're going to think about. But no, not at all, Matt. Love to talk more if you're interested.
That's awesome. Well, we'll take a look, do some snooping around on the website, you know, sure. Take a peek. And then it's great to have you as a connection. I know Dave, so I can get back in touch with you as we're great. Walking through this whole process. The big cool. thing, he's got a chance at a scholarship that could cover a large chunk of his education, which would be a massive relief to us, because we didn't do the greatest job of saving up for college. We just didn't have the resources. So, but that also will be a factor.
Yeah.
In we're going to find that out in the next month or so. So yeah.
Awesome. And yeah, especially on the cross country or the academic side, smaller schools, NIAA schools, they can be quite generous, as can the big schools. Yeah, good luck with that. That's awesome.
Thanks, James. I appreciate that.
You bet. All right, David, sorry for the internet connection in Michigan. Happy to have been with you.
Oh, hey, I appreciate both of you so much. Thanks a lot, guys. Look forward to talking to both of you. And we have some big ideas that Mike and I want to talk to you, James, about doing river shared training there at Rochester in 2024. So let's talk in the near future.
Can't wait. Thanks a lot.
All right. We'll talk to you
later. See you guys. Bye-bye.